Let's pray. Father, we have been encouraged and challenged by this opening song to allow ourselves to be overcome by who you are. Father, Paul expressed it so well in the book of Romans. The challenge that we all face is that on a regular basis, there is the struggle that goes on with all of us of whether we want to be in control or whether we're going to let you be in charge of our life. We've come to this particular place at this specific time today. We call it worship. And yet, Father, I suspect that frequently on these Sunday morning excursions, not just here at New Hope, but everywhere, there is that civil war going on about how much of ourselves is going to still be in charge and how much we're going to allow your presence to overwhelm us. And so, Father, I pray today that the reality of this song will become true within each of our hearts, that we will let your presence overwhelm us. Father, there may be a few folks who've arrived at New Hope today and they're really not sure why they showed up. There was just something that prompted them. And I trust that that something will be discovered for them today, that something really is a someone. And his name is Jesus Christ. That your Son is sufficient not only to forgive us of our sin and to heal us from our unrighteousness, but that your Son, the Lord Jesus, is sufficient for the challenges we face in everyday life. You are sufficient for the challenges of being a husband and a wife. You are sufficient for the challenges of being a son and a daughter. You are sufficient for the challenges of our financial futures. You are sufficient for the challenge of being the employer, employee that honors you in all that we say and do. You are the God who is sufficient to bring us peace in our frustrations. And you are the God who is sufficient to bring us joy when our hearts have been broken. You are the God who is sufficient to heal devastated and broken relationships. And you are the God who is sufficient to give us fresh starts and new beginnings when the old is irreparable because of stubbornness and willful sin. So, Father, we just say thank you for all that you are sufficient to do. And I trust we will give you the privilege to do it today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you so very much for being here today. It's a privilege and an honor for us at New Hope to have you here. If you are a guest for the first time, there are some guest cards, communication cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by a little later. We always promise not to beat on the door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, get information in your hand that will answer most of your questions about what we believe and what our services are, ways you can be engaged in ministry. And those cards are also for our regular church family for prayer requests and communication to staff. Hope you'll take advantage of them. We have 38 members of our congregation, 32 of them high school students, who are up at Hume Lake Christian Camp this weekend. They went up Friday afternoon, drove up in the snow, had to put the chains on, all right, yeah. I would rather them drive in snow than just in cold, icy conditions, all right? So they're going to come home, I think, in that same way. There was a van that went up that was two-wheel drive, and so he's staying here today. And so somebody's is using my car and going up, and John Longstaff, just so there's plenty of folks with four-wheel drive. So just be praying for them as they come out. I was checking the weather report a few minutes ago. It's kind of calm at the moment. But within the next 2 hours, it's supposed to start snowing and not stop till about midnight. So these are the things that stories for decades are made of, all right? Robert Hutchinson was just reminding me yesterday about the time when they went up in a bus, and the back wheel of the bus just caught the edge, and it needed to be pulled back up. It was nowhere near falling off a cliff. But all the tweets and and Facebook posts that went out, you would have thought all these kids were about to die, all right? It was nothing, but they still tell the story about the time they almost fell off a cliff. So anyway, it will be quite fascinating to hear all their stories, but do be praying for them as they travel. And while I'm talking about travel and bad weather, our drummer, John Jericho, his wife is in Ohio. She had to go back with her mom. Her sister was on life support, and the prognosis was not good. And so decisions needed to be made with all of the family there. And so she and her mom went back. The decision was made that this was going to be fully now in God's hands. And when they disconnected from life support, she went to heaven in about 15 minutes. And so she and her mom are on her way home. Travel conditions are not the best across the country today, and so they have requested for us to be praying for them today. So I share that one with you. Let me highlight a few announcements, and then we'll get to some of the other prayer requests I need to bring you updates on. After our last service today at about 12:15 over in the office, leaders of small groups, and if you're not a leader, but you could be a representative for your small group, if your leader can't go, they would love to have you there. We're going to talk about some things we'll be doing in small groups for the rest of the year, so it'd be great to have you there and to have your engagement in that. Starting this Wednesday night is going to be our next jam session. This is the winter jam session. Jam, for those of you who don't know, stands for Jesus and Me. That's the name of our children's ministries from pre-kindergarten all the way through sixth grade. And so their Wednesday night Bible studies and activities are going to begin this coming Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. It goes from 7 to 8, and they would love to have your kids in that. Also, that night, it's an adult Bible study called Little House on the Freeway. What it's like raising kids in today's society. It's a very hurried lifestyle. And so how do we deal with the hurriedness of life with small children? And so one of the ways to make your life less hurried is on Wednesday night, come at 6:15. Don't worry about going home, getting dinner for the kids. Come at 6:15 and have dinner here at the church. Dinner is going to be provided for those families who are bringing their kids, as well as the parents who would like to stay for the Bible study. That way, from as soon as 8 o'clock is here, you all can get your kids and go home and get them ready for school the next day. So Mark Addis will be directing the class on the hurried parents, and our regular kids staff will be taking care of our kids. So that starts this Wednesday night, kicking off dinner at 6:15. Next Sunday is the last Sunday before 10 of us head to the Ivory Coast of Africa. We will be leaving it's 12 days from today. We leave out on Friday early afternoon to drive up to San Francisco. 10 of us with 30 pieces of luggage or containers to get all the way to the Ivory Coast of Africa. We fly out on Saturday around 2 o'clock. We'll be on about a 13-hour plane ride to Paris, France. 2.5 or 3 hour layover in Paris as we meet up with the rest of the 81 people from all over the United States and Canada who are going, largest group ever on this trip. And then we get on a plane for another 7 hours to Abidjan, Ivory Coast, Cote d'Ivoire. We'll get in about 10 o'clock at night. We'll get to bed about midnight. We'll get up at 5 a.m. We will board a bus. I'm making it sound like things that you want to really do with me, huh? And we will get on a bus for about a 15-hour bus ride, if we're fortunate, to end at our destination in Doropo. You still want to go, David?
Yeah.
All right, all right. Then we will begin the 8 days of ministry there in that area, from the Kids Fest to the village of Neonan that we've adopted. If you've got a letter, you have adopted a child, it would be great to get your picture, write a letter, we'll hand-deliver it. Can I just say it this way? I think we've got letters from maybe a third to a half of the kids, and it would not be good to give them out to some kids and the other kids not get them. So if you chose, you know, you signed up to pay for a kid for a year, write a brief letter. Let us, you know, take a picture, attach it with it. Let us deliver it so they can see who is responsible for the blessings of their education, their food, and their clothes for the year, all right? That would be wonderful. We need those by next Sunday, all right? We need those by next Sunday. That would be absolutely terrific if you could do that. But we have a special treat for you. Next Sunday morning, During the 9:15 to 10:45 service, the women in the team, okay, not us guys, though it would be probably beneficial for David to join the group, but it would be a big sacrifice for me to join the group. But these ladies have been rehearsing now, practicing for 2 months, 3 months, almost 3 months with a French teacher. And they have been learning the kids' song that they're going to teach the children in the village in French so that they could sing it with them, all right? So they have learned it. I've been hearing them, all right, in the other room. So I ask if they would sing next Sunday the song, and you'll get it translated in English so you get to know what the song says, but they are going to sing it in French for you, all right? And their French instructor's even coming to hear them, all right? So that will be great fun next Sunday, all right? There is a women's retreat up at Calvin Crest. Fawn, is there anything else I need to tell besides the dates for it? Okay, you can go online, sign up you and your roommate together, all right? And we will do a sign-up so we know how many's going, but you can do this online. I just really think somebody's date on this is just so wrong. It's rodeo weekend, man. So I can't go. It's terrific for you ladies, all right? Glad you're going. You'll have a lot of fun up there. There'll probably still be a lot of snow this year. All right, probably. This year it's going to have a lot of snow. You don't hear a lot about our deacons and this great word that somebody came up with in our elder board meeting, deaconesses. But they're very active in our church in ways behind the scenes you don't often see, in preparing for baptisms and our communions and our usher program, and they see to a lot of things behind the scenes. And some of them are starting to get older and are wanting some additional assistance, all right? And so there is going to be a meeting on February the 5th during the 10:45 worship service over in the office building room with Rich Smith, part of our pastoral staff. And if you would like to know what's involved in becoming a deacon or a deaconess that can provide ministries in the church to help see that they're accomplished and done, going to that meeting is not a commitment. It's just saying, I'd like to know more information about that. And they would love to have you at that meeting. I think this is the last Sunday. We've taken off a few sheets, but volunteers for our Easter choir. I would love to have 30 people in the Easter choir, all right? And I think we're about two-thirds of the way there. If you could carry a tune, you're going to love being with this group. It's always great fun. It's the single biggest, most important day in the year in the history of the world is Easter Sunday. And we want to make a presentation of lifting our voices and honoring Jesus Christ with that wonderful celebration. All right, let me highlight now a couple of prayer requests or updates on ones that are in the bulletin. Polly Good, she's not listed, but she is, I did not know until Friday, she is back in the hospital. She is at Clovis Community Hospital. As you know, she's been battling cancer. The treatment has taken its toll on her, and she is back in the hospital. Kathy Winstead from our church, I understand, is going to be having surgery tomorrow. I hope to have more information about that this afternoon. I would appreciate your ongoing prayers for several families, but a couple in particular that we haven't mentioned lately is my cousin Debbie. Her service is tomorrow here at the church. Debbie was 66 years old, had lots of health issues, and went home to be with the Lord a couple of weeks ago, and that service is here tomorrow. Tyson Kanzler. I did not know Tyson well. I met him about 18 years ago when I had the privilege of marrying his sister and brother-in-law to each other. Tyson's 50 years old. He was a Fresno Unified School District teacher. His last 2 years mostly at Computech. Tyson got sick, went to the doctor, continued to stay sick, went to the doctor, went home, declined a bit, had a bad day. They called for an ambulance to come get him. Between the house and the hospital, he passed away at 50 years of age, and we had his celebration yesterday at Boyce. I would appreciate you remembering the family. They are connected to the Secret Garden florist in downtown Clovis, and I would just appreciate you remembering to pray for them. So those are some of the updates we wanted to share with you. I'm going to ask our ushers, if they would, to come wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please? gentlemen and ladies. Oh, we have two couples today. Oh, this is, it is precious. Yes, it is. Would you join with me as we pray? Father, thank you for being here. You live within us as Christians, not because we were good enough to deserve your presence in us, but because you loved us enough to share your life with us. And when you find a willing heart that says, Lord, I need you. Lord, without you, I'm lost. Forgive me of my willful independence from you up to this moment in time, but I'm ready to surrender my life to you. At that moment, we become a Christian, and your abiding presence within us from now to evermore. And Father, thank you that there's an added promise in the Scripture that says when your church gathers together, when just two or three, Father, there's more than that here today. When we gather in your name, you promise that you will be active in our midst. And so, Lord, I trust that you will be very active and we will be very open to your activity as you speak to us, whether it's through the words of a song, whether it is the thoughtfulness in a prayer, or whether it is the challenge of your Scripture. May we listen to you. We say thanks for the privilege of giving and sharing. We are most grateful. And we commit all this to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Just before the worship team takes off, you guys go ahead and wait on us. Where'd Jim go to? Jim, where are you? Wave, Jim. Wave, Jim, right there. Hey, that guy's 88 years young today. Today. All right? So happy birthday, Jim. Yes, I forgot to give you an update on Jerry Molinari. Jerry had surgery last Monday, as most of you know, and surgery went a lot longer than they anticipated. It was a wonderful lesson on trust and faith. You get a call saying, we're going to have to do a second surgery, and it's going to be a little longer, and you can allow yourself to worry at that moment. And it turned out to be the best of news on the surgery. And 2 days later, it turned out to be the best of news on the pathology, no cancer. And he went home on Thursday afternoon. He is recuperating there. He still has one more important step that he needs to be successful in. That's as delicate as I can put it. If you know, he had work on his colon. So we haven't had that success yet. So we are awaiting that, so just be praying for Jerry. This coming week up in Seattle, Washington, Jerry Brown is going to have that most unusual, new, and unique procedure on his heart. And so I want you to be praying for him. They will be going up, I believe they fly up early on Tuesday, and the procedure is on Wednesday morning. And if this is what blows my mind, if all goes as anticipated, they'll be heading home Thursday evening. All right? Yeah. Now, this is, you know, putting a Gunfo's pump in his heart. I don't think Gunfo's made it, but it's what it looks like. All right? It's very, very tiny. Okay? It's very, very tiny. It's small enough to go up through the major artery in your groin. They run it through the artery, get it in the middle of your heart. They turn this little pump on. It's got a little filter on each end of it, and it takes over the circulatory responsibilities of your blood through your body. Okay? So literally his heart will stop a few times during this procedure, but that's no big deal. Because his pump, I know, it's a little hard for us to get our head around. Your heart stops and it's no big deal because his pump continues to do what it needs to do so that the blood goes through every part of his body. And during that time, they are able to do a Roto-Rooter job on his major arteries. As you know, Jerry has 14 stents in his heart and he can't really have any more and he's not a candidate for open heart surgery. I've done a lot of reading on this since they told me about it, and they've not had anybody die doing this procedure. Nobody yet. And all the reports I read, there was significant improvement with everybody, even men in their 80s who've had this procedure done. So it's pretty remarkable. So please be praying for them in the middle of this week. I know they would appreciate it. I'm going to invite you to find the book of Acts, if you would, please. Acts chapter 2, we're going to be reading a few verses from there in a few minutes. Actually, this is a great Sunday to have your Bibles out, okay? If you didn't bring one, there's some in some of the pews. Avail yourself to them because we're going to go to a lot of places. I know we've got our great technology back there, and she's pretty quick, and this will be throughout the whole sermon if you're going to try to keep up with me, all right? I'll try to give you all heads up on those, but this is a great chance for you to learn where the books of the Bible are today. Before we get to the scripture, I want to tell you a story, and I'm going to ask for your patience as I tell you the story today. This is kind of like a family tree story. You know, it's kind of like granddad sitting down telling where he came from and connecting all the dots of who all the relatives are. I'm going to do a little bit of that today, all right, except it's not my family. I'm going to give you some names that a few of them may be familiar to some of you, but most of them aren't until I get to the last one, okay? So just hang with me, though. There's a reason for doing this today. I want to introduce you this morning to a guy by the name of Edward Kimball. This is not Richard Kimball, okay, from the movie, The Fugitive, all right? This is a real guy. His name is Edward Kimball. He was just an ordinary man who had become a Christian, who taught Sunday school in his church, and he made his living in a shoe store. He sold shoes. But his real passion was not his occupation. His real passion was sharing his faith. He knew the difference that becoming a Christian had made in his life, and he loved to see that same kind of relationship happen in the lives of other people. One day, Edward determined that he was going to look for a moment, a key opportunity, so he could explain his faith. He could share the gospel with a new employee at the shoe store where he worked. The employee's name was Dwight. He had just joined the staff. Edward was very nervous because though he loved sharing his faith, he was not an outspoken person. He was by nature quiet and shy. So one day he hemmed and he hawed and he paced back and forth. Dwight was in the back room putting away boxes of shoes. Finally, Edward burst through the curtains into the back room, mustered up the courage, and launched into the story of who Jesus was from his birth through his life to his death and his resurrection. And then he shared with him the difference that Jesus Christ had made in his life. And he asked Dwight, "What do you think about that?" And Dwight gave his life to Christ in the back of a shoe store. Now that Dwight became better known in history as D.L. Moody. If you've ever heard of Moody Bible College, Moody Publishing Company, that was Dwight, the shoe salesman, that another shoe salesman led to Christ. D.L. Moody was born in 1837 and he died in 1899. In the second part of his life, he became one of the greatest evangelists ever in America. Now, that's not where this story ends. You see, one day, after Moody had become a Christian and an evangelist, he was preaching on an occasion when another pastor heard him. This other pastor was F.B. Meyer. Now, that's a name, again, most of you probably have no idea who he is. For those of us who've been to Bible college, F.B. Meyer wrote a lot of the books that we were required to read during our Bible college years. He was a prolific author, brilliant, brilliant man, as well as a pastor. After F.B. Meyer had heard D.L. Moody speak, he was stirred, and he decided we need to raise the level of preaching in the pulpits of America, and he established a nationwide preaching ministry, and that's why his books became standard reading in Bible colleges even long after his death. Later, while F.B. Meyer was preaching, there was a young man in the audience at one of his services named Wilbur Chapman. Wilbur Chapman was born in 1859, and he died in 1918, and in the mid-course of his life, at a meeting by F.B. Meyer, who had been encouraged by D.L. Moody, who had been led to Christ by Edward Kimball, Wilbur gave his life to Jesus Christ. Chapman later felt the call to become an evangelist. As he was proclaiming the gospel in various places, he decided he couldn't do this job of evangelistic work around the country all by himself, and he needed help. And he heard about a young former baseball player who had just become a Christian, who was very energetic about his faith, and his name was Billy Sunday. Again, not a name a lot of you will recognize, but some of you who are a little older possibly might. Now, Billy Sunday was born in 1862, and he lived until 1935. And Billy Sunday was looking for a job, and Chapman hired him to help him. Billy asked if there were occasions that he could preach instead of Chapman at some of their meetings. And Chapman said, absolutely. Billy Sunday ultimately emerged as the greatest preacher in the first half of the 20th century in America. Go check him out on Google. Now, one day, Billy Sunday was preaching in Charlotte, North Carolina. During that meeting there that was supposed to be a week, that I believe, if my memory's correct, it ended up lasting a month because the move of God was huge. Many people came to know Christ. These new believers over this past month who had come to know Christ under the preaching of Billy Sunday, they thought that the revival shouldn't stop, though Billy had a commitment elsewhere. So they contacted an unknown preacher by the name of Mordecai Ham. Mordecai was born in 1877. He died in 1961. Mordecai Ham set up his tent in Charlotte, where Billy had had his tent, and he kept preaching. It was during that first week that Mordecai Ham was preaching in Charlotte, North Carolina, that a tall, lanky farm boy walked down the aisle and gave his life to Jesus Christ. His name was Billy Frank. You and I know Billy Frank better by another name, Billy Graham. Now, Billy Graham was born in 1918. He's still with us. He's 98 years old, and he's still with us living in North Carolina. And Billy Graham has personally delivered the gospel message to more people than any other single human being who's ever been born on the face of the earth. Do you know why that story is important? Because it started with Edward Kimball. It's not because it ended with Billy Graham. What's important about the story is it started with Edward Kimball. And the question I've got next is, who's going to be after Billy Graham? Who's going to be the one out of many of his crusades? And there are several who have stepped into worldwide evangelism because of that. But I want you to understand, from D.L. Moody to F.B. Meyer to Billy Sunday to Billy Graham, four of the greatest evangelists in the history of the world, and it all got started with a shoe salesman. So consider this. Because an ordinary guy like Edward Kimball was willing to share the gospel with a coworker, millions have heard the gospel message. It's worth noting that there's not one person in the entire New Testament, that whole first century church, who came to faith in Jesus Christ apart from the agency of one human being telling another human being. It is one person telling somebody about somebody who can make a difference in their lives. That is God's chosen method of evangelism. The message was always designed to be personally communicated. In that first century church, they didn't have any tracts, they didn't have Christian TV, they didn't have radio, they didn't have Facebook or Twitter. They had to share their faith face to face. God in His wisdom has chosen people to communicate His message. And although God can get the job done without us, you and I can never get the job done without Him. And I dare say most of us, I cannot say all of us in this room, have a personal walk with Jesus Christ. All of us can, because Jesus loves every one of us. He's knocked at our door, and He's waiting for us to open the door. And if you haven't opened that door, a great day for you to do that. Get in this lineage from Kimball to Graham, all right? Get in that lineage. Invite Christ in your life. But the vast majority of us, you come every Sunday. Some of you have been coming just a few Sundays. Some of you have been coming for 30 years. The thing is you and I are Christians today because somebody evangelized us. You and I have faith in Jesus Christ, and we have a hope and assurance of heaven because in some form or fashion, somebody spoke into our lives about the person of Jesus Christ. It may simply have been an invitation, would you go to church with me? It may have been them seeing you pray over your lunch at work. It may have been because they had a tragedy in their life and you came alongside and you assisted them, but in some way you shared the gospel with them. In the book of Acts, chapter 2, we get a picture of how all this got started in the first century. The book of Acts is the history of the first century church, the group of believers who didn't have a religion anymore. Okay, they didn't have a religion anymore. They had this thing called Jesus. And they were trying to figure out, what do we do now? He lived with us. He died for us. He rose again on our behalf. He's now, in Acts chapter 1, he ascended and went back to heaven where he came from. He returned back to us in the person of the Holy Spirit, who had not lived inside the human spirit of a man or a woman since Adam and Eve messed it up in the garden. And now that Jesus had finished his work, he had paid the price so that once again, God in the person of the Holy Spirit can now come live within our human spirits, and we could now be who God intended us to be from the very beginning of time, his children. We get a sneak peek at how this got started in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and there were many wonders and signs that were done by the apostles. All the believers were together. They were in unity, and they had a common purpose, everything in common. They sold possessions and goods, and they gave to others who had need. And every day they continued to meet together in temple courts. Not just on Sunday in those days. They did it every day. They were thirsty and hungry. They broke bread in their homes. Here's the first home groups. Okay, small groups right here. And they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And what happened? The Lord added to their number, how often? Daily, those who were what? Being saved. The church moved out. They moved out into the world, and the individual members shared their faith with others, and God added to them every single day. I want us to look, we're going to look at about three or four passages of Scripture, just one right after another. I want you to get a sense of how God delights in doing this. Go to the book of Romans. It's the next door neighbor to Acts to the right. So just go right in your Bible to Romans chapter 10. That might be the prettiest sound in the world. Leaves of Bibles turning. Romans chapter 10, verses, I'm going to jump in at verse 11 through 17. And Paul writes, as the Scripture says, everyone who trusts in him, who's him? Jesus Christ. He's illustrated in the previous verses. They will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. Get rid of the prejudice. For the same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be what? Saved. Saved from what? First off, saved from their sin, all right? Might be the hardest thing that prompts people not to want to become a Christian is to admit they are sinners. God says, I will save you from your sin, and because we have been saved from sin, we are now saved from, another word we don't like, hell, okay? It's not our destiny. Heaven is. How then can they who are not saved, how can they call on the one whom they have not believed in, and how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard, and how can they hear without someone preaching to them, and how can they preach unless they are sent? And that is written, how beautiful are the feet, the ugliest part of our body, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And this is not just for those who preach. It's for those who share. For anyone who shares the good news of Jesus Christ is a preacher. And the Bible says, yes, there are some who are called and gifted in the ministry of preaching and evangelism, but all of us are called to be ambassadors of reconciliation. Same book of Romans, all right? All of us, not just a small group of us, all of us as believers in Jesus Christ are called to be his ambassadors. Ambassadors are representatives, and what is the purpose of that representative? To bring reconciliation between the individual and the one we represent, who is Jesus Christ. Beautiful will your feet be if you are engaged in sharing your faith. Go all the way back to the first book in the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. The last chapter of the first book, all right? Matthew, right before Mark. Matthew chapter 28, the closing words of Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. It's called the Great Commission. The 11 remaining disciples, Judas Iscariot is absent because he hung himself after his denial of Christ. The other 11 have met with Jesus on the mountain. It's where Jesus told him to go. And if Jesus tells you to go somewhere, what should you do? You should go, okay? If he sends you, you ought to be sent, okay? And how long should you stay? Till he tells you to go. Major Thomas used to preach a sermon called Sent, Went, and Put. I was sent, so I went, and I stayed put, all right? And it's a pretty good short sermon there. And then Jesus came to them and said, verse 18, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. This verse took new life in my life 3 years ago. When in Africa, I was invited by a village pastor to come preach in his village and afterwards to baptize 10 people in his congregation. Two more were added because two got saved that morning in the village church. How people get saved when you got a white boy from California who only speaks English and a translator goes from French to Lobi to the dialect of that village. How you get saved? That's God's work. It's not human work. That's God's work. But to literally fulfill the Great Commission to another nation, baptizing them in a bathtub. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. And then one more, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 18. Ephesians chapter 5. All right. If you remember where Romans was, go right a little more. All right, and it's Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, all right? So you got Romans, and then 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and then Galatians, and then you'll find Ephesians. It's not very many pages because those aren't very long books. So Ephesians 5. Verses 15 through 18. I'm going to be reading out of the New Living Translation for this one, but you can follow with what's up there or what you have in your hand. But Paul wrote these words, so be careful how you live, not as fools, but as those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity for doing good in these evil days. Let's pause quickly. This was written approximately 2,000 years ago. Do you think the days are less evil or more evil than they were then? Probably more. Don't act thoughtlessly. To do that would be to live as a fool. But try to understand what the Lord wants you to do. Make the most of every opportunity. That's what evangelism is for all of us. Not just for the one gifted like a Billy Graham or a D.L. Moody, but making the most of every opportunity is what all of us as God's children should be engaged in. All of us have been evangelized, and yet we're terrified of the word evangelism. That's not my job. It's not, I can't do that. There was a guy by the name of Kimball in a shoe store who didn't think he would be very good at it either. And yet, look at what history records for us. If we seek, if we ask, and if we knock, God will give us opportunities to share our faith as His ambassadors. 2 Peter 3:9, you don't need to turn there. Let me just read it for you. 2 Peter 3:9 says, He does not want anyone to perish, so he's giving more time for everyone to repent. You and I have been given the privilege of grace. God waited long enough for you and I to repent. And he continues to wait because there are others, and God wants to use you and me to share in the others that God is extending this time to come to know him. In about the next 5 minutes, I'm going to highlight one character out of the Bible. I've highlighted Edward Kimball out of history. Out of the scriptures, I want to highlight just one character that not much is known about. His name is Andrew. The New Testament shows, quite frankly, very little interest in Andrew. His name only occurs 12 times in the entire New Testament, and four of those 12 times, one-third of those 12 times, it's just a list of the disciples being recorded. It's all 12 of their names telling us who they are. In the New Testament, it seems that Andrew is always living in his brother's shadow. His brother, if you don't know, is Simon Peter. Andrew's original name in the Greek literally means courage. And I think Andrew shows the same kind of courage that Edward Kimball did in his life. When we look at the three instances in the Bible where Andrew made a difference in people's lives, we discover that he was a very godly man who had a willingness to tell other people about Jesus Christ. And like Andrew, if Jesus Christ is important to us, we have that same message that we can share with others as well. And I think we can learn from Andrew's life who the other people are in our world that we should share our faith with. So, if you want to turn with me to the Gospel of John, that's where the next three passages are going to come from. So, John chapter 1, and we're going to jump in at verse 35. John chapter 1, verse 35, and we're going to let Andrew show us who is one part of the world that we ought to share our faith with. John 1, jumping in at verse 35. The next day, John, this is John the Baptist, not John who wrote this book. And if I'd read verses before, you would know I'm correct. The next day, John the Baptist was there again and two of his disciples. And when he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. John the Baptist, the one who said, "I am the forerunner of Jesus Christ, Jesus, I am not worthy to even untie his sandals," he's the one you ought to follow. Andrew, we're going to find out it was Andrew in just a moment. Andrew was a disciple of John the Baptist first. And when John the Baptist pointed to Jesus and said, "There's the Lamb of God," Andrew changed his allegiance from a man to God the Son. When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" By the way, Jesus, he was a CCW permit holder. He carried the Holy Spirit with him, all right, which was a big secret in those days. "What do you want?" he said. They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him, and it was about the 10th hour. And Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed him. And the first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah." Then he brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You'll be called Cephas," which translated is Peter. The first thing that Andrew did after he met Jesus was to go tell his brother. And the first thing that Andrew did turned out to be the most faithful thing that Andrew ever did. And because of that, it ended up being the finest thing that Andrew ever did, was telling his brother about Jesus. Like Andrew, if we know Christ, we need to let our family know how important Jesus Christ is. We can't make them believe, but we can bring them to him. And the rest is up to Jesus. The second passage I want us to look at is John 6, John 6, just a couple of pages to the right from where we are. John 6. This is a famous story. Many of you probably know it. It's the feeding of the 5,000, but Andrew plays a significant role in this. Beginning at verse 1 of chapter 6, sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he had performed on the sick. And then Jesus went up on the hillside, and he sat down with his disciples, and the Jewish Passover feast was near, meaning it was springtime. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. You see, some things might catch us by surprise, but they never catch Jesus unprepared. Philip answered him, 8 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each one to have just a bite in this crowd. Heavy eaters. Verse 8, another of his disciples. Who? Andrew. Who's Andrew? Simon Peter. Every time Andrew's mentioned, it's Simon Peter's brother. Okay? And Andrew says, "Here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. How far will they go amongst so many?" Do you see what Andrew did? He didn't know what was going to happen, but he brought the boy to Jesus. And now it's up to the boy and Jesus to figure out what's going to happen. And Jesus took a few loaves of bread and a few small fish, and he just started breaking it off. And he fed 5,000. And just to put an exclamation point for the disciples, he said, "The disciples, hey, each of you get a basket and go pick up leftovers." And guess how many baskets of leftovers there were? 12. How many disciples are there? Yeah, that was a memory lesson. Don't forget. And so I suggest to you that what this lesson teaches us is disregard the difference of age. Andrew was a grown man, an adult, and yet he brings a boy to Jesus. Don't just think it's just my age group I can minister to and lead to Christ. Bring whoever God puts in your path. And last of all, John chapter 12, just 6 more chapters in the Gospel of John, verse 20. John 12, verse 20. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the feast. And who was at the feast? Was the feast for the Greeks? No. The feast was for the Jews. 2 very different cultures. 2 very different ethnic groups. They came to Philip, who was from Bethesda in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Boy, it's really fun when in evangelism they walk up to you and say, "Could you tell me about Jesus?" And it does happen on occasions. It does. If we're seeking, if we're open, if we're ready, and if we want, it happens. Notice what Philip does. Philip went to tell Andrew. This was not in Philip's wheelhouse. So he goes to Andrew. He knew that Andrew was a guy who took people to see Jesus. And so Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. And so the challenge for us here, I think, is, hey, look beyond the color of your skin. Look beyond the economic, social status that you might be a part of. God's arms are wide. Doesn't make any difference the color of our skin or the ethnicity of our background or the economic well-being or lack thereof. All have fallen short of the glory of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish. We cannot limit the gospel of the grace of God to any particular segment of society. So I wrap this up. What did we learn from Andrew? Bring our family to Jesus. Reach across generational divides and bring them to Jesus. Reach across racial divides and bring them to Jesus. 3 aspects of evangelism that I hope you can walk away with today are these: that evangelism is a lifestyle for every believer, It's not an occasional activity. Number two, evangelism is more about action than words. Notice Andrew. He brought them to Jesus. He brought them to Jesus. It's his actions. And successful evangelism involves relationships. We got to get to know people. And in that knowing them, we've got to share Christ with them. Now, in the last 5 minutes of this sermon, it's very different. There was a strategic purpose for this message today. Several months ago, I started talking to you about the fact that Luis Palau is coming to the Central Valley. He's going to be engaged in a weekend of evangelistic outreach. Men like D.L. Moody and Billy Sunday and Billy Graham and Luis Palau are specially gifted by God for the purpose of evangelism. That does not mean they are to be the only evangelists. You and I are called to the process of evangelism. They are uniquely gifted. Have you ever wondered why millions of people in the course of Billy Graham's life have come to know Christ? Have you heard better sermons on the radio? You probably have. There are a lot of guys out there who I've heard in my lifetime preach better sermons than Billy Graham. But Billy Graham is gifted with evangelism, and he's doing what he was called to do. Luis Palau has been gifted with it. He's the Billy Graham of Latin America who happens to be in North America right now. And God has gifted him with the ability. Now, doesn't it seem reasonable if all of us are called to be engaged in the process of evangelism that we ought to get in on the coattails of somebody who is gifted with evangelism? Doesn't that just kind of make a little sense? And so that's our challenge. And if you'll recall, several months ago, we passed out cards. You all began to write down some names of people who you knew, friends or family, that you'd love to have come to know Jesus Christ. And we turned those cards in. And every day since we turned those cards in, there has been a committee that meets at the headquarters office in Fresno. And they pray over every single name in the cities of Fresno, Clovis, and Central California. They've been praying over those names ever since then. And I hope you've been praying over the list of names you've turned in and saying, God, what opportunities are you going to? How can I invite them to be a part of this? So what I want to do in my last 5 or 6 minutes here is I want to give you an update because we are now in the home run stretch, all right? The dates of the event are April 1st and 2nd. We were supposed to have these flyers to pass out today, but they got stuck in the snow in Denver, Colorado. So they didn't make the Thursday meeting, okay? And so we should have them this week. If not, we'll make our own so we can put them in your hands. But I wanted to talk about this today. The events are April 1st and 2nd. That is a Saturday and Sunday. I love the idea that April Fool's Day is a day that many people can stop being a fool in their sin and they can start becoming a fool for Jesus Christ. These events are not going to be like the old typical revival meetings when I was a kid growing up and what Billy Graham does. These are some activity events to capture a younger generation on Saturday. There's going to be all kinds of sporting activity events outdoors at the Save Mart Center. They're going to have some BMX things going on. There are some soccer things going on. There's going to be professional athletes there. Let me tell you who part of the lineup for the speaking times are going to be. Luis Palau is going to be the primary speaker at some other events. Andrew Palau will speak. Some of the folks coming to sing, all right, and I don't mean the word entertainment, but to prepare us. And I don't know, I can tell you my age is showing right now because everybody in the room, when they announced these, clapped. I smiled. For Keene and Country. All right, yeah, you guys are hip. All right. Marisol Park, she's a big name out of Latin America. Okay, she's beautiful. All right, she's a lot better looking than these other guys with these goofy haircuts. Lincoln Brewster. Okay. Lecrae. Okay, a black rapper, all right, who knows Jesus and loves him. These are guys, so, you know, your kids are probably going to want to come to hear these guys. And then a CrossFit champion, Rich Froning. Okay, ladies, I shouldn't say that. Go check him out on Google, all right. When I saw his body, I said, God, I told him, don't use my picture ever again.
This guy's a stud, man. There's all kinds of fitness competitions, and we'll have details of the timing for all this in the next week or two. Now, that's out of the way. There are some things leading up to that that you need to know about. First of all, friendship evangelism training. Any and all of you can take this training, much like we did with Operation Andrew for Billy Graham. This is a training time, all right, to teach you. If you would like to be a volunteer at the Crusade event, and when people are invited to come forward, you can be one of those down front that can help lead somebody to Christ. And the people you're leading to Christ, more than likely, will be complete strangers who've come down and said, "Could you take me to Jesus?" So it's about as easy as it gets, all right? But there's some training for that. And taking this training does not commit you to being one of those down front counselors. But this gives you the training that you'll find helpful in your own life, sharing with your families or your friends. The two I would recommend are February 6th and 7th. And unfortunately, I'm going to be out of town, but we've got others from our staff who will be going. The one on February, and these are 2 hours, 7 to 9 in the evening. February 6th, it's meeting at North Point Community Church. Pack your lunch. That's over by 99, okay? And then the one the next evening, this is a Monday night and a Tuesday night, is at Cornerstone Church. That's the old Wilson Theater, downtown Fresno. Why I hardly recommend those two is because special guest Mark Middleberg is going to teach those two sessions. And Mark Middleberg was the one who led these programs for Bill Hybels in Chicago and for Lee Strobel, all right, at his church. So there's also one in Clovis on February the 9th at 6:30 in the evening at Mountain View Church. He's really not in Clovis, but he'd like to be. That really is a Fresno address. We call him a Clovis wannabe, all right, but it's close enough that we let him in. And then we have three other dates, and we hope to get all these out to you. I'll probably pass a sign-up sheet to see how many of you'd like to go. In the 8 o'clock service, about half of them said, "I'd like to take the course." 2 hours on how to share your faith with other people. Also, there's going to be prison ministry opportunities to serve. They're teaming up with Prison Fellowship, and they'll be going into prisons in the Valley on March the 24th through the 28th. And if you would like to be a volunteer to go into prison, you can go to the Fresno City Fest website, and it will tell you how to do it. We have a little inside track here. You can also ask any of the PF people, "What do I have to do to become a volunteer in that organization?" There are also two luncheons. One is a women's luncheon on March the 29th, and we'll probably do a sign-up sheet soon to see how many would like to go, but here's the deal. They're really pushing. Only buy a ticket for the luncheon if you're going to buy another ticket to bring somebody who doesn't know Jesus Christ. This is an evangelism outreach. This is not just to rah-rah the church. This is to reach out, okay? And then there's also one, it's called a Business Civic Luncheon, and it is on March the 30th, and we'll give you more update on that. But what I really wanted you to know is there's training sessions, ways that will help you learn how to share your faith in a friendly way with your own family and friends. You can use it at the crusade, but you can also use it after the crusade is over on an ongoing basis. Just a quick thing, then we'll let you go. How many of you think you might be interested in going to one of the training sessions on friendship evangelism? Would you raise your hand? You think you might like to go? Perfect, wonderful. We'll send a sign-up sheet around. And for some of those that are a long ways, the one in Clovis at Mountain View, everybody can find your way there, but maybe if you go to some other nights, you can make some arrangements where you meet here at the church. You could carpool to get to those that are a little farther out, whether it's downtown Fresno or on the west side of Fresno. But great, thank you. Would you join with me as we pray? And we'll wrap up today. Father, thank you for life. Without your life, we would not have eternal life. Without your life, dying would be the most miserable experience in the world. But Father, because of your life, death doesn't have to hold any fear for us. As one gentleman whose memorial service we had just in the last day or two, his favorite line when somebody would ask him how he was, he would say, "It's just another day. It's just another day." And Father, for the child of God who knows you, the day of their death is just another day. Because the scripture says, though we die, yet shall we live. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to instantly be present with the Lord. It is just another day. So, Father, I pray for the growing faith and the growing trust that brings us to that kind of attitude, the kind of attitude that we rest in you in all the events of our life, and also that we rest in you in sharing our faith with others. If we have the good news, why do we want to keep that good news to ourselves? So help us, Father, to have the courage and the desire to share you with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.